Welcome to today's broadcast. I am sure you will be blessed at the end of this broadcast. Please stay tuned.
So this morning I'll be sharing briefly what I've titled, Harnessing the Course of Your Life. Harnessing the Course of Your Life. Harnessing, controlling, or directing us, monitoring the course of your life. Now, it's not as easy as I've stated it, you know. It looks like I can control, I can harness, I can control the course of my life. But as we look into this and we'll look at what exactly am I talking about. Praise the Lord. I'll be brief, and let's turn the Bibles to Genesis chapter 4 from verse 1. You know the story. It's about Cain and Abel. But I'll read Genesis chapter 4 from verse 1. It says, and Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. And she again bare his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. So these are two directions. You know, the course of a life, one of them chose to be a keeper of sheep. The other one was a tiller of ground. And the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. And Abel also brought of the firstling of his flock and of the fat thereof. And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering. But unto Cain and to his offering, he had no respect. Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. And the Lord said unto Cain, why art thou wroth? And why is thy countenance fallen? If thou doest well, shalt thou not be accepted? And if thou doest not well, he says here, sin lieth at the door, and unto thee shall be his desire. And that shall rule over him. Can you turn to NLT? NLT version, please. Okay, you're seeing it verse 2. So, is anybody with NLT? Genesis 4 verse, I think I'm in verse 7 now. NLT. He said, you'll be accepted if you do what is right. But if you refuse to do what is right, then watch out. Sin is crouching at the door, eager to control you. Sin is at the door, eager to control you. But you must subdue it and be its master. At this point in time, yes, he was incensed that God accepted the offering of Abel, and his wasn't accepted. God had no respect for it. God pointed out something, that sin is at the door. And he's telling me, at the door, you have the lever. You have the handle to the door. You have the lever. Don't turn that lever. Don't open that door. The sin is crouching there. It looked like mere envy, you know, jealousy. Cain didn't set out to be a murderer. He didn't set out to be a murderer. What was before him was envy. He was jealous that God didn't accept his offering. But it was at the door. And God told him, you have the lever to the door. You have control over that door. Don't open that door. The enemy is crouching. He wants to come in. It looks more like an envy. It's envy that we have every day, jealous for somebody, and we bear grudge, we're not letting go, you know, all that. They look little, but as little as they are, in the hands of a snake, in the hands of the devil, who has been existing for a while, it can turn to something you don't intend for it to happen. Praise the Lord. He didn't set out to be a murderer. But it was this little sin that was crouching. that he eventually not turned the liver and allowed it, that it not festered, and now turned it to what? Him killing his what? Brother. How did it happen? Why did he have to turn the liver? How come a little jealousy has now transited into a capital murder? His cause was, there was a tiller of ground, and there was a chance for him to redeem his image. You know, do the right thing. There's nothing wrong with your curse. He has a curse chartered for himself. But see how sin that was just at the door, that he let come in, has now degenerated into what? Murder. And from becoming a tiller of ground, he now became what? A murderer, and he became a wanderer. Praise the Lord. He changed the course of his life by what? Turning what? The lever of that door. Now, if you can, turn to Matthew chapter 15, verse 19. Matthew chapter 15, verse 19, please. He said, for from the heart come what? Evil thought. From the heart. The door he let open was his heart. From the heart comes evil thought. From the heart comes what? Murder. It is from the heart. It is not something that he decided to do instantaneously, off the cuff. It was something that he allowed in. See, the enemy knows how to make a tapestry of evil. He knows how to string things together to give you a tapestry of evil. All you need to do not let it come into your heart. Because Bible says here, evil thought, murder, adultery, all sexual immorality, theft, stealing, lying, slander, they all come from the heart, from the heart. From the heart. And it brings me down to Proverbs chapter 4:23. If you can, Proverbs 4:23. It comes from the heart. It comes from the heart. Murder. It don't set out to be a murderer. It don't set out to be an adulterer. It don't set out to be a thief. It don't set out to commit all manner of vices. They all emanate from the heart. That is why the Bible says here, guard your what? Heart. Above all else. There are many things we guard. There are many things we chase. There are many things we desire to have. He said, above all. Above all. If there's anything that needs mounting a guard over, it is your heart. Because it determines the what? The course of your life. If you are able to man guard over your heart, you can determine the course of your life. I talked about harnessing the course of your life. It is not that directly. If you're able to mount guard or guard your heart, you can determine the what? Because it is the heart that determines the course of your life. The course of life of Cain shifted because the heart took charge. He had the liver. The thing about it is that we don't have the inspiration to murder. We don't have the inspiration. It doesn't come from us. It is the enemy that knows how to do it. Our heart is like, our life is like in an open thing, sort of, that when we let in coming, what we have is just a choice of what we allow to come in or what we don't allow to come in. The enemy takes it from there. The heart. No, Bible says in Jeremiah, said that the heart is desperately what? Wicked. It is deceitful and it's wicked. Who can know it? And Bible said God searches the heart. The heart is important because it is from there. The Bible says, out of it are the issues of life, the outgoings of life. There's everything that affects you comes from the heart. Your heart is like a receptacle. Praise the Lord. If you look at Luke chapter 6, verse 45, you can, please. Luke 6, 45. Luke 6, 45. If you can, Kim King James, please. So your best laid plans can be overruled by your heart. Your heart can railroad your best intention into a decision that you never intended to have. He said, a good man out of the good treasure of his what? Heart. Bringeth forth that which is what? Good. A good man, good treasure, good fruit. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good. And an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is what? Evil. For of the abundance of the heart, the mouth what? Speaks. And so you find out here is that the heart is like a receptacle, a depository or repository, like a storehouse. It's like a treasure house. Now, what you store is what your heart adapts to. What you let come into you. It calls him a good man, not because he's a good man by nomenclature. He becomes a good man because of the good treasure in his what? Heart. He produces what he produces because of the good treasure that is in his what? So when I talk about my heart, when I talk about heart, talk about your mind. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Your mind. He's a good man. Out of the good treasure of his heart, he brings forth that which is good. An evil man, out of the evil treasure of his heart, bringeth forth that which is evil. For out of the abundance of the heart, the man what? The mouth what? Speaks. Out of the abundance, the mouth speaks. The heart at best is a receptacle. It is a storehouse of treasure. The heart is what defines you. Your heart content is what defines you. Your heart adapts to the content you have let it into it. Your heart is like a receptacle. If you let in anger, if you let in unforgiveness, if you let in things, those little things, in quote, Bible said, that spoils the vine. When you let them in into your heart, the enemy knows how to string events to come out, to bring out a design you have no idea about. People do things not because they have that inspiration, because there is a master, a wicked master that knows how to, you know, join things together to bring out a tapestry that is evil. Praise the Lord. A tapestry that is evil. That is what the devil is master at. A good man out of the good heart of the... Sometimes it is not apparent. You don't know the nature of my heart. I don't know what it is. It cannot be more than the quality of your heart. Your heart is what defines you. Your heart is what qualifies you. That is why Bible said God does not look at the what? Outward man. God looks at the what? At the heart. And he says something that, look, people draw near me with their lips, but their heart is far from what? From me. God looks at the heart. What actually identifies you? Your identity is derived by your heart content. If you're a good man, it's because your heart content is good. If you're an evil man, it's because your heart content is what? Evil. Evil. And so these things, murder and the rest, don't come out of our own ingenuity. They come because of the content of our heart. How long are we going to allow things to keep coming into our heart? How long will you allow envy to fester? How long will you allow unforgiveness to fester? How long will you allow divisiveness, slander? How long will you allow grudge to fester? These things, they look minor, but the enemy has a way to string them together to bring out a tapestry that is evil. And that is what identifies, that is what qualifies you. That is what qualifies you as a person. You are not good because you do good things. You are good because your heart content is good. Because you have good treasure. Our hearts are like receptacles. Are like repositories. They receive what you are left. All you have is that liver. All you have is, when I say liver, all you have is that handle. Judah opened the door. Jesus said something. I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and opens the what? I will come into him and sup with him and him with what? With me. Praise the Lord. Let's look at Matthew chapter 7, verse 16. Matthew 7, 16. And he said, you shall know them by their fruits. He said, do men gather grapes or thorns or figs or thistles? Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good what? Fruit. Every good tree brings forth good fruit. But a corrupt tree brings forth what? Corrupt what? Fruit. Evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit. You say, look, this is not me. No, it is you. Just that you don't know your heart. You don't know your heart. You don't know your heart. You don't know what you have assimilated. You don't know what you have let come into your heart. And it's building up, it's brewing, it's building up. It's going to come out something that is evil. We have so many evil things happening or evil actions. Not because we intend to, but because our heart is dark. Because the treasure's there. Our hearts have adapted to the content we have allowed to come into our heart. Our hearts adapt to the treasure we have allowed, we have amassed there. It will take us the cluttering. It will take us taking off those evil treasures so that our hearts can be free. Praise the Lord. The content of the heart, it's what characterizes it. The heart is evil because of its content. You could imagine a white cloth. And if I dip it into perhaps a pocket of dark ink, what happens to this white? It changes to what? Black. Is it not? Black and changes to black. Why? Because what? It has adapted into the what? Into the adapted to the color of the ink where I have dipped into. It's like a heart. So the heart is evil because of its content. Like I said before, your heart determines your course of life, whether it is left, whether it is right. Let's look at 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 6. 1 Samuel 16, verse 6. Look at what God says here. It said, it came to pass when they were come, they looked on Eliab and said, surely the Lord's anointed is before him. But the Lord said unto Samuel, look not on his countenance, on his height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord seeth not as much yet. For man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh what? On the heart. God looks at the heart. The heart, the Bible says, guard your heart. For out of it are the issues of life. Out of it are the outgoings of life. It is the source of whatever affects you in life. People are affected by their heart content. People are affected by what they have let into their heart. We must understand, Lucy, I learned this from Ben Carson. You know, sometimes we spend time on what we're not supposed to spend time on. There is nothing you assimilate that lives anywhere. It stays on your mind. Praise the Lord. There is nothing that you assimilate, whether through reading, whether hearing, whatever gauge it comes through that lives your life. It stays in your mind. There are billions, millions of neurons in your brain. It has everything. I just that at some point in time, it will just do a flash and show you what you thought about when you were little or not. But just that we are carefree or we are careless in actually, you know what they call clickbaits? You know, so the internet has become fraught with evil, with a lot of things. that the enemy is a master of clickbait. So quickly click on this thing, look at this, click on it. So the more you click and look and observe, you are taking in what? You're taking in treasures into your heart. You're taking in wrong things into your heart. And the more you take it, Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart, the what? The mouth speak. And so you are assimilating things that will one day need to be spilled out. You ask, where, how come I'm saying this thing? It's because over time you've assimilated things you ought not to have assimilated. But Solomon says something, the eye cannot see enough to be what? Satisfied. The ear cannot hear enough to be what? There is nothing you see that you will ever be satisfied. That is in Ecclesiastes chapter 1. He said it again in Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Your eye cannot see enough to be satisfied. So why do you fixate your eyes on things that you know will not help your heart content? Knowing that, look, your heart will always adapt to what you have let in as a treasure. Your heart becomes darkened because the treasures are evil. Your heart becomes good because the treasures are good. And so the box stops with us. What are you letting in into your heart? What are you letting in into your heart? Have you broken the bank where anything at all can just flow in? We are no longer protecting our space. Every joke can fly in before us. Anything can go, all around us. There is no barrier. There is no delineation. There is no control over your environment. It ought not be. Sin is crouching at your door. You will have control over it. The heart is important because you don't even understand it. But listen, it is when the fruit starts coming out, you begin to wonder, how did this thing happen? It wasn't your idea. It was the enemy that taped it together. It was the enemy that stringed it together. Our hearts are affecting us. The content of our hearts are affecting our produce. We're no longer living righteously, not because we are not trying our best, but because the heart is wrong. Because we have stuffed our heart. No wonder when David fell and stuff, he was saying, he said, create in me what? A clean heart. Renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence. Do not let your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of my salvation and renew a right spirit within me. You are trudging, you're making mistakes because the heart content is wrong. Everything about it is wrong. It is evil. And therefore, what we produce are evil fruits, evil outcome. And devil is smiling. Devil is happy. Devil is gloating that we are doing what is displeasing to God. It is high time we begin to man guard over our heart. What are you allowing to come into your heart? It is affecting the course of your life. Cain did not set out to be a murderer. It was little envy, in quote, that degenerated to what? Becoming a murderer. He was a tiller of ground. But at the moment he became a murderer, his course of life, what? Changed. He became a wanderer. And had the tag of a mother that nobody can kill. Praise the Lord. What are you letting in into your heart? Let's turn our Bibles to Romans chapter 6. I'll read a couple of scripture there and then. Romans chapter 6. Maybe verse 8. Where's my scripture? Now, if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. Next verse. Knowing that the Christ being raised from the dead died no more. Death has no more dominion over him. Next verse. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Next verse. Likewise, reckon ye yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Next verse. For let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in the lust thereof. That you should obey it in the lust thereof. This thing signifies that, okay, if you could go back a bit, that truly we don't have initiatives of ourselves. And I keep saying this because you need to have an understanding, because we can attribute, you know, reasons for what we do and all whatnot. We don't have the initiative to do evil. It is the enemy that comes up with those initiatives. But what we have is the control of allowing what comes in or what goes out. So let not sin means it is within my power. It's within my authority to let sin not reign over me. That I should obey is lost. So sin has lost. So what I do when I sin, what I do, I obey it is in is what? Is what? Lost. I obey. What we do, we obey voices. We obey an initiative, either the voice of God or the voice of the enemy. We don't have inherent initiative. We don't have it. What we have is the choice we have to choose who to obey, whether it is sin not to death or what? Sin not to death or what? Hallelujah. So go to verse 13. Neither yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves what? Unto God, as though they are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments. And so we yield our members either as instruments of unrighteousness or instruments of righteousness to God. Either yield yourself as instrument to sin, or you yield yourself to God. Praise the Lord. Go to the next verse. For sin shall not have what? Dominion over you. For you're not under the law, but what? Under grace. Next verse. For then shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? But God forbid. Next verse. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves, servants to what? So we yield ourselves, servants, to obey. His servants are ye to whom you what? Obey. Whether to what? Sin unto death. And what? Obedience unto what? I was looking for this. Obedience unto righteousness. And so it says something that is important, is that we are all servants obeying a voice. Obeying sin unto death, or obeying what? Obeying God unto what? Righteousness. We don't have initiatives. What we have is our members. We decide who to obey or who not to obey. But I foresee, Bible say, let not, means it is within my power, it is within my authority to allow sin to come into my life or not to come into my life. But as for initiate, we don't have that initiative. We don't have it. We don't have an initiative. We only obey voices. We only obey voices. Voices of sin will lead to death, but the obedience to God will lead to what? Righteousness. We don't have that initiative. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. If you turn the Bibles to John chapter 13, verse 1. John 13, verse 1. Bible says here, and now before the feast of Passover, when Jesus knew that the hour was come, that he should depart out of the world unto the Father, having loved his own that were in the world, he loved them unto the end, and the supper being ended. And the devil, having now put word into the heart of what? Go to the next verse, please. And so, ended. And the devil, having now put into the heart of what? Judas Iscariot. To what? Betray what? To betray Jesus. This caught my attention. Jesus didn't have initiative to betray Jesus. You know that? He didn't have it. Who put in his heart? The devil put in his heart to betray Jesus. But did he start from here? Did he start here? What was he? What was he? What was his role among the disciples? Huh? He was a treasurer, isn't it? But what was he doing? He was dipping his hands, is it not, into the treasury, into the pocket that was meant for the assembly, it was meant for the disciples. But, you know, he created an inroad. The enemy, he created an inroad for there to be a deposit of evil. And as it kept accumulating, it came to a point, the highlight of what the enemy intended to do, he put in his heart, it is time. Betray Jesus. To show you, look, see, it starts from somewhere. We have to protect our space. People need to qualify to come into your space. A drunk need not to be in your space. A harlot need not to be in your space. Praise the Lord. I'm talking about, you know, things. I may not just mention it, but I mean, people need to qualify to be in your space. If you must maintain your chastity, your integrity, people must qualify to come into your space. What are you allowing to come within your space? Because it is affecting what gets deposited in your heart. And when it's deposited in your heart, it's actually identifying you. Your identity is derived from your heart content. Your identity is derived from your heart content. If your heart content is evil, your identity is that you're evil. When your heart content is good, your identity is your what? That you are good. But you must what? Protect your what? Your space. You must protect what's coming. You must protect your eye, protect your ear. Praise the Lord. You must not allow the enemy to sow in, to put things into your heart. You must stand your ground and decide, look, for me to live is Christ, and for me to die is what? To gain. Decide, look, draw the line. The enemy cannot have. If you look at Job chapter 31, verse 1. Job, the Bible said there is that, Job says, I have made a covenant with my what? Eyes. Why then should I look upon what a maid? Why then should I look upon a maid? I have made a covenant with my eyes. Why then should I look upon a maid? Why then should I look upon a maid? You must decide. What he's doing here is that he's protecting his space. He's deciding, look, there are guardrails around me that I don't need to cross. Certain things need to qualify to come into my space. There are guardrails there. What is your guardrail around you, about you? First of all, you must understand, the Bible says, for so great a salvation we have received. Do you actually value the salvation you have? Jesus said something. What shall it profit a man if he gains the what? And lose what? His own soul. If you have no value for your soul, anything can come into your space. Praise the Lord. If you have no value for the salvation you have received, anything can come in. You can allow anything come in. If there is no appreciation of the life that you have, yes, it's a life that has a lot of, in quote, suffering, because this is not the final destination. It's a life that, you know, demands a lot of deprivations. Praise the Lord. Bible said, you, whatever you've lost, you will what? You would find. But it's asking you, what shall it profit you if you gain the whole world? There is no way in life you can gain the whole world. But it's assuming if you gain the whole world, is it worth your soul? Is it worth your life? Is it worth your soul? Is it worth your soul? If there is no value placed on your salvation, on your soul, anything can come into your space. We need to awake. We need to come back to the table and realize, look, we have received a salvation that took someone's life. Praise the Lord. A salvation that cost Jesus his life. A salvation that caused a deity to become man, so that you and I can be here, presented here, so that we can have a future ahead of us. Praise the Lord. If there is no value for your soul, anything can come into your space. You become evil because your heart content is evil. But that will not be your case in the name of Jesus. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'll read about Ananias. Acts chapter 5 from verse 1, please. But a certain man called Ananias and with Sapphira, his wife, sold a possession and kept back part of the price. The wife also being privy to it, bought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled thy what heart to lie to the Holy Ghost? Why has Satan filled thy heart? Why have you allowed the enemy to fill your heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? It speaks, why have you allowed? It means that Ananias had the control, had the lever. But look at what happened. He allowed the enemy to fill his heart so they can lie to the Holy Ghost. But what's the end point of this man? I don't think he set out, he had good intention. He wanted to help, you know, the Christian faith that was still burgeoning. He wanted to help, you know, so that, you know, they can be food that can be spread abroad, that can be shared among the brethren. Praise the Lord. He had a good intention, but he allowed the enemy to what filled his heart to lie to the Holy Ghost. And what was the end point of that? He lost his life. It changed the course of a life. A man from his own money wanted to help as, you know, a benevolent person. Ended up what? Dying. Why? Because he allowed the enemy to sow lies into him, which he lied against the Holy Spirit. And he lost it. He lost his life. Bible in 2 Chronicles 16:9. Bible said the eyes of the Lord runs to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose hearts are what? Perfect toward him. Whose hearts are perfect. God is looking at your heart. Your heart is changing the course of your life. God is looking at your heart. It is your decision. One of the things I'm going to share in this first service is, how do I man God? How do I help myself? How do I make sure that I am within the confines of good treasure? How do I make sure that, you know, I don't let in things that will pollute me, that will make me corrupt, that will, where my identity will be derived as a corrupt person? No. I want to allow the good to come into me. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. If you look at Galatians chapter 6, 16. No, sorry, chapter 5, sorry, please. 5:16. And he says that, I say then, walk in the Spirit and you will not what? Fulfill the lust of the flesh. Walk in the Spirit. Walk in the Spirit. Subject yourself, yield your members as instruments of righteousness. Say, walk in the Spirit and you will not fulfill the lust of your flesh. Go to the next verse. For For the flesh lusteth against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. These are what? Contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that ye would. You cannot do the things that you would, because the heart takes control. The heart takes control. Next verse. Praise the Lord. Okay. But if you are what? Led of the Spirit, you are not under the what? Law. So now, the works of the flesh are manifest. Verse 19. Which are these? Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresy, envies, murders, drunkenness, reveling, and such like, of which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do these things shall not inherit the what? The kingdom of God. One of the ways is, look, yield yourself to the Holy Spirit. It is high time you submit. I know that you want to enjoy your life at your own terms. But listen, that enjoyment, let it not turn to something that will change the course of your life. You cannot predict what your heart can do. It is not much about your heart, it's about the wicked one behind who is stringing events to make you see. When people do things, for example, commit murder, do you know that they don't even know what pushed them to that point? It is when it has happened and it cannot be reversed, you know, their eye what opens. It could be small quarrel for a couple that could have, okay, see, I'm sorry, I'll move on. But that quarrel could actually lead to a death of a spouse. You know that? You don't know. It's not heard of. You've not seen it in the news before. Quarrel. One takes up knife, you know, trying to scare the other person. And from scaring, it happens. The enemy perfects the plan. Why? Because they allowed little thing into the bosom of their heart. They allowed the enemy that was crouching, the sin that was crouching at the door. They humanly turn the lever and they allow the enemy to come in. And from there, the enemy is the master. He knows how to string events. And they turn out to be an outcome that will change the purpose. A spouse that set up to have a good life, one is dead and the other one is incarcerated. What a change in the course of your life. You can actually harness the course of your life if you're able to harness the course of your heart. Praise the Lord. If you're able to man guard over your heart, what comes through your heart, you can actually control the course of your life. But now it can only happen when you surrender to the Holy Spirit, when you yield to Him. So the Holy Spirit, Bible said He will guide in John chapter 14 and John chapter 6. He said He will guide you into what? All truth. He will guide you. Bible says He's the Spirit of truth and He will guide you into all truth. And so in life, I don't think that anybody wants to walk in lies. You don't want to toe a path you have no idea about. You want to walk in truth. The master of truth is the Holy Spirit. All you need to do, the test of maturity is, look, Lord, I surrender to you. Meanwhile, Bible said, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the what? That is Romans 8:14. As many as are, what authenticates your sonship is that you are led by the Spirit of God. If you're not led by the Spirit of God, according to the scripture, you are not a son of God. Because in life, you serve. You think your whole self, you serve. We are all servants. Either you are serving sin unto death, or you are serving obedience unto our righteousness. Praise the Lord. We are all servants. I am a servant. No matter how big I am, no matter my age, I am a servant. I don't have an inherent initiative. I don't have an inherent initiative. I always use this, I let's tell my son, sort of when I'm talking to him, if somebody, curses you, so the expectation is you curse back. It's not good measure, present, shake it there and running over. You should give it back to him. But no, I always say, look, when you curse, you will hear, behind you hear the voice, curse back, is it not? Is it not? Curse back. There's a voice behind you. And so what you do, you are actually serving a voice. Either the voice of sin or the voice of God. And so as for service, we are all servants. Bible said, no man can serve what? God. Yeah, two masters at a time. Either you serve God or you serve what? Mammon. And so we are servants. We don't have inherent initiative. We are servants. But look, in the moment you understand you're a servant, that look, it is binary. The choice is binary. Either I am serving the Holy Spirit, I am serving an evil spirit. And serving the Holy Spirit will help, shape your life. He said he will guide you into all what? Truth. Means he will guide the course of your life to truth. You make less mistake. You dabble into wrong things because what the guide there is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit guides you. And so if you want to protect your heart, if you want to mark God over your heart, if you want to harness the course of your life, if you want to determine that your course of your life is the right direction, you must what? You must yield your members. You must yield your heart to the Holy Spirit. Let him lead you. Let him guide you in the best way he has charted for you. He has been in the beginning. The Bible said, in the beginning, what? The world was with what? God created the heavens and the earth was without form and void. And the Spirit of God was what? Over it. The Spirit has been in existence before the world was created. So there is nothing on earth or in heaven he does not have an idea about. When you surrender to him and yield him, look, Holy Spirit, I'm yielding myself to you. I have made mistakes about my life up to this point. But look, I want to move my life forward. I want to make progress. Sometimes we'll be stuck because of our heart content. But look, when you yield yourself to Holy Spirit, you make less mistakes. Praise the Lord. He said they will guide you into all truth. Not some truth, into all truth. But you must be willing to hand over your heart to him. See, there is this urge that you want to be in control. You can be in control and send yourself down to hell. You can choose to lose control and send yourself up in heaven. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Cede control to the Holy Spirit. If you don't cede control to the Holy Spirit, you will cede control to the devil. It is binary. There is no middle path. Sorry. There is no middle point. It's always binary. Control to the Holy Spirit or control to what? To the evil spirit. If you want to move your life forward, if you want your life to have a curse that you look back and say, indeed, God is faithful, you must yield your members. You must yield your heart to the Spirit to guide you. Praise the Lord. I want us to be in our faith this morning.
Thank you for watching today's broadcast. If you were blessed by the message and you would like us to pray with you, or you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, feel free to write to us via email, mails@harvesterscity@gmail.com, and we will respond immediately. This message was brought to you by Harvester City. God bless you, real good.
Everybody
say amen.
God
has spoken.
So let the church
say.